This is the virtual happy hour experience with the Drunken Grape. I am your host, Rob. And today we have another extraordinary individual going along with the theme of extraordinary drinks with extraordinary people. This gentleman has survived tragedy. He survived a lot of difficulties and really marched his path towards excellence. He's built a massive community online, but behind that community itself, he is a true audiovisual expert. We love to hear the buzzword of content creation in today's world, especially on social media. It seems like every person can deem themselves a content creator, but a real content creator, that is a massive amount of skill. I know just working with my videographer on some of my projects, just that end, how big it is. And when you add in all the sound, you add in the theatrics, the graphics on top of that component, it really takes a master to do so. And today we are going to introduce my guest. He is awesome. Russ Johns, welcome to the show, the head of the Pirate Syndicate. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm better than average. Now I'm even better with you. Rob, thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Well, and you know, and you are an extraordinary individual. I've been following your path on LinkedIn for a number of years now, I think at least three or four. I've watched this massive community grow with your live broadcast. You know, you've got the Pirate broadcast. I myself am proud to say I'm a pirate. I've been on that broadcast. And it's not only what you do with the community, Russ, it's what you do behind the scenes. We know we were talking a bit about that. Your life journey in a lot of ways wasn't easy. And, you know, to talk a little bit about that to start, and, you know, it's a common theme that extraordinary people who become great champions go through great adversity. It's almost like the rite of passage. You have to go through, whether it was bullying, a freak accident, loss of loved ones at a young age, a loss of a lover that you loved either through death or marriage, a bankruptcy in a key business and you had to start over. It always seems to be the path, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, and you just listed almost a lot of what I've experienced in life. So it's one of those things that you have to use it as a fuel for your future. You know, staying in a dark place and feeling like a victim is not necessarily as productive as we need it to be. And that's what I really have built my theme of my life of. And, you know, some of the things that I've developed over time is this idea that, you know, kindness is cool and smiles are free. And that's because you don't know where people are coming from. You don't know what journey or what tragedy they're, you know, getting through at that point in their life. So it's just a matter of being able to respect and respond and have a little bit of compassion to what people are going through.
You know, and you couldn't have put it better than anybody else on this planet. I mean, that's a great summation. It's factual. It's even, you know, we're dealing with the pandemic and you see some people making fun of people driving alone in their car with a mask on. They're going, aha, what a buffoon. And I'm thinking, man, you got no clue of what that person is climbing through. I mean, that person is going through a lot of challenges. That person is could be going through health problems. They could have a serious condition that getting something just a bit beyond the flu could kill them quite literally. And there'd be nothing saving them, even with the vaccinations. We don't know. So you're right. I mean, you don't know the cover story. What we see is, we don't know what's behind the cover story. That's a better way to say it. We don't know the depth of what's really going on. And I know for yourself, you had a tragic accident and you recovered from it miraculously. I think you fell, did you not? A substantial fall.
Yeah, I was a musician one day and I fell three stories. You know, if you look at a three-story building and imagine falling off the roof of a three-story building, and I grabbed a ladder on the way down and broke eight rungs of an aluminum ladder until I hit the ground and shattered my arm, my wrist, damaged my leg, you know, lost a finger. And, you know, a number of different complications along the way. And it took over two years to just, you know, rehab and recover and kind of get back to a state of stability. And being a drummer and, you know, losing your arm, you know, I wasn't in Def Leppard, so I wasn't able to, you know, come back in the same way. and I had a family started, you know, I was married at the time. And so I just took the opportunity that was in front of me and continued to pursue learning and growing and evolving. And, you know, it saved me in the long run,
you know,
and I made a decision.
Yeah.
I made a decision at that point in time, Rob, to actually decide that I'm here for a reason. There's a reason I'm alive. So let's make the most of it.
Yeah. I mean, that will shake you to the core. My experience that probably shook me most, and this is where I can fully relate with you and really having to redirect your focus, was the loss of my twin sister. I don't think I will ever feel anything as painful as that ever again. Even losing a key lover will not be the same pain. I mean, this is somebody that we're literally glued to the hip from birth on in the womb. I called her my wombmate jokingly. Right. But it's true. And, you know, to get off that and just bring back to your story, a fall like that, so many people would have quit, and you can't really fault them. You can't really fault somebody for reacting that way, because you don't know, like you said, the backstory. You don't know what's going on inside them. You don't know what support they have. And I imagined you had an outpour of some support to really pull you through. Some key family members stepped up, some key friends stepped up. And it's often people out of the woodwork, I find, that you least expect it sometimes, that make their appearance into your life right at the right moment, right when you need them. And they help pull you through.
Yeah. Well, you know, the one thing that that helped bring a little light in my life at that point in time was the birth of my first son. And, you know, we hadn't really been attempting to have kids. And then, well, we had some free time on our hands that, we decided to have kids. And so for the, you know, first, I don't know, year of rehab, I'd be in surgeries every other month or so. And, so once he was born, I got to spend the first year of his life just being there with him, being dad and hanging out and enjoying the time of, his first year of life.
Yeah.
And it was an amazing, amazing time and an opportunity. And it's just like, hey, I'm going to make the most of it. I'm going to do what I can. I'm going to, excel at whatever I happen to do. And at the end of the 2 years, the company that I was working for asked me back to work. They said, we love what you were doing, you know, your work ethic and all of the things you brought to the team, and would love to have you come back. And so I returned to the company and then became the safety director.
Wow.
So wow. I had some credibility.
Yeah. I mean, that's a great comeback in itself. And you obviously moved this meter a lot further along. And this is why I think you're so extraordinary. I mean, you stepped out on your own. I mean, you've been out on your own for quite a number of years now. There's a number of clients that you service. Obviously, being an audiovisual sound and content creative expert, you really understand the nuts and bolts behind the scenes on the tech end. And we're not talking on a small vlogging kit here. We're talking about large scale video production.
Oh, yeah. I have, the company I work for, radio, television, broadcasting. We at one point in time owned the Seattle Sonics. And wow. So, you know, events and activities and large productions were part of, you know, some of the things that I had to contribute to. And learning that technology and learning that industry and learning about the production process. And I've actually done audio work for, independent film. I did audio and editing for radio commercials and a lot of activities like that, that just added to my toolbox of skill. And so I've just brought that forward in the content creation process, Rob.
Yeah. And what a masterful way to do it. And it's, I had my last guest and that show, the shows always sort of precede each other, Greg Campbell. He was part of Organized Rhyme. I don't know if you ever heard that, but it was a rap group with Tom Green, the Hollywood celebrity. They're from Ottawa and they're friends.
Okay.
And I listened to his path about how he was in the music with that career, went into real estate, and now he's moved back and he's cut a single that's tremendous. It's actually on that episode. And it's with his wife, who's like this soul singer. And it's a culmination of all these years of experience and skill pulling together at a masterful level. And we discussed this when you've got at least, really when you get to the 7 to 10 year mark, I mean, you're not the master, but you have a level of mastery now where you are truly, really competent at all levels. Like you really understand trends, you understand where things are going. And I mean, in your business, you think about it. I mean, video back in the 80s or 70s, I mean, it was reel to reel, which you probably have experience with. Then you had experience with Betamax and VHS. Then everything went to Blu-ray and DVD. This is hilarious at the timeline. And I think somewhere in between, they had those video disc players. They're like, they looked like Frisbees going in, almost like a record. And I mean, it got shot out faster than anything, never took off. And then of course you've got everything on MP4 video now or .MOV. And I mean, the sequence just keeps developing and the technology has made it easier for sure. I mean, look how we're talking right now. This technology, we wouldn't even fathom doing this 20 years ago. We visualized it happening, but we were like, wow, it's come here so quick. But
we wish it would happen, right?
Yeah.
We
wish
it was so much easier. So
yeah, but it's through all of that, there's obviously you have such a huge understanding because your knowledge goes all the way back in this massive timeline.
Yeah.
And that's experience you can't trade. You know, if you're watching this, you know, make sure to subscribe to this. Make sure to connect with Russ. I'm going to have all of the details in the description of this show. And the contents in the description of the show. But if you're listening to this, ladies and gentlemen, this is really important. This is why you want experts like Russ. If you are a mid-size, especially small to mid-sized businesses, you're a profitable business. We all know that if you're casted in the old ways of marketing, for instance, content creation is vital now, vital more than ever. You're not going to be able to cold call people. There is no yellow pages. Banner ads done on the roadside don't really work anymore. People tune in and the number one thing they tune in on is this guy right here. You know, and the second thing they tune on is the computer screens we're communicating through. And I know your depth of knowledge on this side is very, very high. And this is, it's also all the background knowledge that you have that leads to the excellence in production, I would think anyway.
Well, it's the accumulation of a little bit of knowledge in a lot of space. You know, just like the wine industry and you have different varieties, you have different varietals, you have things that you add to your, it's like, okay, I'm note to self, I'm going to learn and pocket that for a future time. And all of these little experiences that you have from the production, making mistakes,
of course,
you know, not doing something as ideal as it could be, you acquire this skill set and just learn about it. And sometimes, Rob, one of the things that we suffer from most is the cone of knowledge, where we think, if I know this, probably everybody knows this, so therefore it's probably not that valuable. And the reality is that when you step outside and you realize how much information you've actually accumulated and how much you've actually experienced, everybody has a gift. Everybody has a message that you can actually draw from. You can actually pull some information from and use it to help other people. And that's really what it's about, is storytelling. You're a great storyteller. You understand the dynamics of what that means and what that looks like. And video is the same way. Audio is the same way.
Oh yeah.
And just being able to, like you said, on the smartphone today, be able to fire it up, tell a story, bring it to life and share it with others is an amazing accomplishment for anyone.
It is. And it's, you know, on the professional end, it's also important to have the level of depth you have, because if I'm a company and I'm turning around, I'm going to spend $50,000 to build a sound room. And that's probably an inexpensive one. But if I want to build a sound booth for sales and marketing purposes, vlogging, podcasts, and I think every mid-sized to large company should have a podcast room personally, and it should be outfitted with state-of-the-art equipment. You're definitely the man I would point to on this platform. I don't know anybody who knows this stuff better than you, quite frankly. And I would just go, I know one person in mind that can outfit you from head to tail. Not only that, they could show you how to present that podcast by doing a test video for you. They can actually, they actually have their content too. And this is, this is the cool part. And I just cracked this. This is an Imperial Stout. This is back from the 17th and 18th centuries, part of the first industrial style to go global by the British Empire because they controlled shipping. You know, you're looking at something. This is from Waller Street Brewing. I always love supporting local. These guys are downtown, like a mile and a half away from where I live, near Ottawa University or University of Ottawa. And I think they're in the basement of an old heritage building. But, you know, you get those roasted notes, those coffee notes. Yeah. There's a bit of mocha in here. I always find there's prune, dates, figs, some dried fruit that sits in there. Some of you get dried raisins, nuts. Great with things like vanilla ice cream in the summer. You know, if you got a lady friend, and a lot of ladies typically who look at you and go, Russ, I can't stand beer. Get that crap away from me. Introduce them to a stout and they'll change their mind about 95% of the time. And I think everybody loves the taste of coffee or chocolate or mocha that comes into these things. And there's always a little bite of bitterness.
It has a great body too. I love the body of Imperial Stout.
So what do you have in your hand, my friend? You know, this is the happy hour. It's the happy hour. So we got to share
a happy hour. I got a little scotch.
Cheers, man. Get that up to the camera. Cheers, brother.
Take care. So we enjoy hanging out and having a happy hour with you.
Yeah, what are you drinking? What type of scotch?
It's what did I grab? I grabbed a I think it's a Duard's.
Okay.
So just a mid brand, nothing special, but
aged any particular period at all?
No.
I think it's 12 years. Yeah, I mean, if it's 12 years, the minimum age of the blend of anything in that blend will be 12. And it's interesting because that whole three-year aging concept came about in Scotland in 1916. But it actually started
in 1916?
Yeah, that's when they put the law through. But it started in Canada in 1887.
Interesting.
And we were the first ones to come up with a law here, and it was against bootlegging and moonshine on rye production. And that's why these things came about, is to checkmate the people who were doing the backyard distilling. And it was undercutting it was undercutting these distilleries.
So in order to get that a little more strict, they added the requirements for aging.
Yeah, then especially in order to classify it as scotch.
Got it.
And you know how much it costs to barrel stuff and store it. So your bootleggers, there's, you know, running off moonshine and things like this, zero chance that they could actually produce it at that capacity. It took an industrial scale to do so. Yeah. So that's why these larger distilleries muscled it through with the government. You know, sometimes it's interesting because in the booze business, often things go against it, like excise taxes. Government just loves to tax alcohol consumption to death because they know that we can't escape enjoying it as en masse as a population. Well, it's true. It's the same thing as cannabis up here in Canada now in various parts of the States. I'm a big fan of cannabis myself, you know, and I know you are too. And it's like a CBD and all this stuff, but they know it's a ready source. But sometimes some good comes out of a legislative piece. You know, this legal document comes out and actually protects things that are good. It keeps a standard. Yeah. Obviously,
it's nice to have a standard so you know what you're going to get.
Right.
In respect to, you know, when you have a bottle, is, you know, is it 2 weeks or is it 20 years? You know, it's you need to know.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's great that you're a Scotch fan. It's always great to have people who are aficionados on this show. Makes it roll, makes it fun. Talk a bit about the Pirate Broadcast. You know, I absolutely love that slogan. You got to patent it or trademark it. Kindness is cool. That hashtag is addictive. It floats all over LinkedIn. You know, I don't know how many people have started to use that, but I've seen it come pretty common, especially when people are engaging with you. And, you know, you have a massive following. I've watched this following explode, but it's a real following. I mean, you did this all organically. You did this all honestly. You built this on your own efforts and you built it with great content. That's what I love. The content is great. It's original. You have some really awesome and interesting people on your live broadcasts. Ladies and gentlemen, make sure to tune into Russ's live broadcasts. They're really worth listening into. I think sometimes you have them pretty early in the morning, do you not? But this is a great time for people to tune in. You're getting ready for the office, or you're up. Now that the office is home, most people have a cup of coffee in their hand at that hour anyway. And the beauty is you don't have to worry about your coworker looking at you or eavesdropping over. You can just turn on what you want. And a program like this is awesome. It's a great thing to watch. Gets you into good moods.
Yeah. And thank you so much for saying that. And it's available on, you know, all the platforms, Spotify, even Audible on Amazon. And the reality, Rob, is there's a lot of people, like we were talking before the show started, is there are a lot of people that may not have the opportunity to share their gifts and their message. And that's really what the Pirate Broadcast is all about, is the idea that we can highlight what people are doing, how they're building their communities, or, you know, growing their business or doing things that they're focused on. They're not necessarily focused on building a content creation organization like I am. However, they still deserve the opportunity to be sharing their message and their voice. And I think it's important, and I think it's necessary. And it's one of the passions that I have, being in content creation for so many years, is like, that's a great story. I want to share it. I want to have somebody else hear it. It's just not a call between you and I, it's a call between us and a lot of other people. So, and as you know, I've been on LinkedIn for a number of years creating content. And I'm not the biggest, there's a lot of people that have bigger audiences than I do, and that's okay. I do what I can, and I help those that are willing to contribute and participate. So it's great to have pirates like yourself, giving back and having a show of your own and seeing it. Yeah, I love what you're doing, and
thanks, man.
Continue to promote, So let's high tide raises all boats. That's why
I agree, and it sort of showcases to people what they can do. I started off, for instance, like yourself, with ad hoc video work. I would do an odd ad hoc wine or beer tasting back 2017 when I really reignited LinkedIn again, probably 2016, probably around the time that I launched the Drunken Grape as a proprietorship and moved it forward. And I look back now, and some of the stuff was just, wasn't the best content. It was a bit rough and raw, even though I had a lot of public, I had 20 years behind me at that point in time, if not about that, of public speaking and presentation experience and being on television. But actually doing your own show or creating your own content's a totally different animal. And I tell people, just get the reps in. One of my best friends said this the other day. He goes, Rob, we're talking about contract and contract worth. And I told him I had a story that everybody goes through in the world of business as somebody tries to knock your price down. Now, it might be for honest reasons. It might be for dishonest ones. But once you set a rate, you have to adhere to that rate. And it's getting the reps in. If somebody's watching this, and I guarantee somebody's watching this show that has never created content before, just start. Just try it. Get the reps in, because my buddy said the more reps you get in, you become a really polished machine over time in presentations. And if you're strong in a subject, that makes you very powerful and very marketable in the world. And it's just getting that exercise in. And it is great to give back, and to finally turn around. I was thinking of a show idea for years. And, it was one of those things. I had an aha moment into the spring. I said, aha, the virtual happy hour experience. This is a great idea. I can bring in people who are just aficionados, generalists, all the way to super high-end experts like Jennifer Simonati Bryan or Nova Catamatri or Roger Mittag. They're wine and beer pros at a genius level, and not only intellect, but education. They're off the charts. To the person that likes tech but loves bourbon. Or like yourself, you love scotch, or you've got somebody on that just loves to drink craft beer. Greg last week loves to drink Pilsner. So he talked about his time in the Czech Republic and his experience in Prague with it. And this is it. And then you get to highlight what other people do. And this is the joy. Everyone knows what we do already. All they have to do is go to our page and just go, wine and beer guy. Yep, audiovisual and content expert has a show. Yep, get it. Yeah, but to really be able to do the give back, and we can wrap this up with it. This is the genius and the beauty of your show, The Pirate Broadcast, is you are an expert at giving back. It showcases people. And I am sure there's hundreds of people now that you've helped springboard into bigger and better things. And I don't even mean that lightly. I mean that in a very, very serious and visceral note.
Yeah, it's amazing to watch how people have taken ownership of their own journey and actually started their own show. And actually, you know, there's a lot of things that go in the back office that people don't realize how much effort and time and energy it takes. And that's why, you know, that's one of the things that, with the Pirate Syndicate, is your experience getting on board and getting on the show and the notifications that go along with it, the ease of access to get on, you know, get signed up and access it, the promotion that goes into it, the social media content that goes into it. And that's why I created the Pirate Syndicate, to support shows like the Pirate Broadcast. So anyone that doesn't want to deal with the overwhelm of the technology, and they don't want to deal with all of the nuances of the process, I'm here to help you. So you can show up and, you know, turn the mic on, go live, and build authority. It's pretty simple equation. So it's all the way from, I'll show you what you need to know, to I'll do it for you. And that's my sweet spot. And that's where I'm going to stick in my lane and continue to grow it.
Yeah. You're really good at it. And I love the whole pirate concept. I mean, you even look kind of like a pirate. We could take those glasses off, put a patch on. You should do it on a Halloween episode. I'll laugh my ass off.
Yeah.
Fucking brilliant. But it's just, you know, it's true. And it's not like there's not other people. I mean, I'm going to give a big shout out to Nancy Burrows. She has launched her own show. It takes guts. Yep. She is really a big up and comer on this platform. You have Raquel Boris, who, you know, does a whole variety of things for our youth. You have Jason Leibowitz. I think he's got Connections Over Convenience is his hashtag. He works with her on a lot of this content in the back end. Then you have the brilliance of Brian Schulman and Tim Son, you know, the Saturday morning television, or the Saturday cartoons, they call it, with the Saturday, what is that? Shout out Saturday. I mean, this is just, it's neat to see some awesome, awesome shows. You have Russ Hedge, you have Peter Clark, we're talking about, with Red TV. He's got his live broadcasts. And for anyone watching this, these are the people you want to look up to. Like, take a look at what they're all doing. Follow Russ Johns. Connect with them. You know, Russ, you've been an extraordinary guest. Cheers to you once again, brother. Much love.
Take care.
I'm going to have the notes in this show. It's always a pleasure to talk with you. You're one of my favorite people. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever you decide to do, happy, happy hour. Have a terrific day. This is Rob from the Drunken Grape.